சோ இந்த வருஷம் நம்பர் 16 மென்ஷன் அபவுட் த்ரீ கைண்ட்ஸ் ஆஃப் சகாம பக்தாஸ் ஆர்த்தோ அர்த்தார்த்த ஜிக்னாசுர் நவ் இன் 29th வர்ஸ் இஸ் டாக்கிங் அபவுட் த ஃபோர்த் கைண்ட் ஆஃப் சகாம பக்தா ஹூ வாண்ட் ஓன்லி முக்தி தே பிராக்டிஸ் பக்தி ஃபார் த சேக் ஆஃப் கெட்டிங் லிபரேஷன் தே டேக் ஷெல்டர் ஆஃப் சுப்ரீம் லார்ட் இன் ஆர்டர் டு கெட் லிபரேஷன் ஆஸ் சூன் ஆஸ் பாசிபிள் ஆஸ் எர்லி ஆஸ் பாசிபிள் தட்ஸ் வை இட் இஸ் மென்ஷன் தட் ஜெரா மரண மோக்ஷாயா their only desire is to get liberation from birth and death thus mam ashritya etantite they perform ashtanga yoga having taken shelter of me so thus this kind of bhakta is called as yoga mishra bhakta he is performing devotional service but mixed with yoga and this person te brahma tad vidu krishnam adhyatmam karma chakilam by such practice of yoga mishra bhakti they will understand who they are brahma means who they are completely about them about their knowledge along with all the things that are connected to them adhyatmam and they also understand that by what they are taking birth again and again in this material world what is the cause for their repeated birth in this material world and they also understand about what kind of karma they are performing in this material world and what are the results of the karma in this material world all the things connected to them they get an understanding by performing yoga mishra bhakti but these people are eagerly anticipating to get liberation immediately they are called sakama bhaktas so they are also included among sakama bhaktas just like a paper boat floating in water can be destroyed any moment similarly this human body can be destroyed any moment however if we take shelter of krishna we can go beyond this ocean of material existence we can one can go back home back to godhead so here it is mentioned those yogis who strive to destroy birth old age and death jara marana mokshaya etanti etanti mean they strive to destroy the birth death old age etc who desire liberation only their only desire is to get liberation consequently worship my deity form and know all about the famous brahman they know all about the famous jiva about himself and themselves along with things connected to it they understand who they are and they understand everything connected to them they also know about the jiva present at the controller of the body and the repeated bodies of the jiva generated from all types of action due to the power of devotion to me so by the power of that devotion they understand the cause of their repeated birth and death and they also understand about the various activities and their results so all these kind of information understanding they will actually get so one interesting thing is that here in this verse Lord Krishna is actually introducing some new terms the terms called as brahma term called as adhyatma term called karma and also in the next verse he also introduced four more terms the seventh chapter which is talking about these seven words are elaborately explained in the eighth chapter their meaning is explained in the eighth chapter here Lord Krishna only says that this person who practices yoga mishra bhakti who practices bhakti will get the proper understanding of these six terms and will also remember me at the time of death and then come to me after giving up this body that is what is Lord Krishna mentions in the last two verses which is a connection to the next chapter by worshipping my form they realize their object of knowledge that is brahman that is themselves aham brahmasmi that understanding they will get and attain liberation but they do not bring me under control are become object of my affection because these people are practicing bhakti with a desire to get moksha with a desire to overcome the cycle of birth and death they will get moksha but they will not become the pure devotee of the supreme lord thus they will not bring the supreme lord under their control and they will not become the object of affection of the supreme lord because they are worshipping the supreme lord for moksha and lord will give the moksha very easily without any difficulty. That the Smriti said, Sakrit yad anga pratimanta rahita mano mayim bhagavatim dadau gatim. Says that, even if only once or even by force one brings the form of the Supreme Lord into one's mind, one can attain the supreme salvation by His mercy. It's basically, it says that even if once with strictly meditate upon the Supreme Lord, strictly think about the Supreme Lord will fulfill our desire. And if they are thinking about liberation, the Supreme Lord gives mukti very easily. Muktim dadati karichit smana bhakti yogam. The Supreme Lord gives mukti, anyone if want mukti, but He will not give pure bhakti easily. Lord Krishna giving pure bhakti means He has to give Himself to them. That He will only give to His ananya bhaktas, not to everyone. For others He can give bhakti or mukti very easily. So then Lord Krishna concludes this chapter saying that the knowledge attained by their service to me is never destroyed. Such kind of knowledge cannot be destroyed even at the time of death. With that, Lord Krishna concludes this chapter. Sadi bhutadi devam mam sadi yajnam cha evidu prayana kale pichamam te vidur yukta chetasa.
Those in full consciousness of me, who know me, the Supreme Lord, to be the governing principle of the material manifestation of the demigods and of all methods of sacrifice, can understand and know me, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, even at the time of death.
So here, such kind of a person who practices bhakti unto me, even mixed with yoga or mixed with jnana or mixed with karma, eventually, when they come to the proper position, then they also understand me as the source of all the bodies for all the living entities, Adi Bhutam, as the governing principle in the form of universal form, Adi Daivam, and also as Paramatma, who is supervising all the activities of our life, which are called as Yajnas. Whatever activity you perform, then they can be called as Yajna, as it is described in the fourth chapter of Bhagavad Gita. Every activity that we perform can be called as Yajna, and that Yajna is inspired by, supervised by Paramatma, and that Paramatma is called as Ati Yajna. So one will understand all these things, and with that understanding, when one continues one's bhakti in one's lifetime, even at the time of death, prayana kalepi chamam te vidur yukta chetsa, one will not forget about me, one will not forget the knowledge about me, and hence one will come to my abode. So this is how Lord Krishna concludes this chapter. Those who develop such knowledge of me as the source of the body, the universal form, and as the Paramatma, by the influence of devotion to me, maintain that knowledge even at the time of death. So by the practice of bhakti, one will understand about Brahma, one will understand about Adhyatma, one will understand about karma, one will understand about Adibhuta, one will understand about Adi Daiva, and one will understand about Adi Yajna. And one who understands about all these things will easily remember me at the time of death. One who remembers me at the time of death will come to my abode. So in that way, Lord Krishna giving a connection to the next chapter. Lord Krishna will elaborate all the 7 items in the next chapter very nicely. So it is mentioned in this verse, the devotees alone. So this is the essence of this entire chapter, chapter 7. The devotees alone, enumerated as 6 types, who know the truth about the Lord, cross over Maya. This has been presented at the meaning of the 7th chapter. Who are the 6 types of devotees who alone can understand the Supreme Lord? The 3 types of Sakama Bhaktas. They are called Karma Mishra Bhaktas, who are Artho Jignasu Artharthi, who are mentioned in 7th, 16th verse. And the fourth kind of Sakama Bhakta is Mokshakami or Yoga Mishra Bhakta, mentioned in the 29th verse. And there is one Nishkama Bhakta who is called Jnana Mishra Bhakta, who is mentioned in the 16th verse as Jnani. And there is a Kevala Bhakta who was mentioned in the first verse of the 7th chapter. So they are the six kind of devotees. Only they understand about the Supreme Lord. And they only understand about Brahman. They understand about Adhyatma. They understand about karma. They understand about Adibhuta. They understand about Adidaiva. And they understand about Adi Yajna, the Paramatma. And only they will remember the Supreme Lord at the time of death. And they will go back home back to Godhead. My devotees of six tribes know me in truth. And they cross over Maya and they come to me. So this is the essence of 7th chapter. In the previous six chapters, specifically from chapter 2 to chapter 6, Lord Krishna spoke about Pradhani Bhuta Bhakti, not Pradhani Bhuta, Guna Bhuta Bhakti. The people who generally practice Karma Yoga, Jnana Yoga, Ashtanga Yoga also have Bhakti in their process. They attain the fulfillment of their desires, attainment of Sahaja Mukti or Sarishta Mukti. That is explained in the previous six chapters. Now in the 7th chapter, Lord Krishna talked about six kinds of devotees. They are called as Pradhani Bhuta Bhakti. Bhakti mixed with karma, they are called Sakama Bhaktas. Or Bhakti mixed with Jnana, they are called Nishkama Bhaktas or Jnana Mishra Bhaktas. Even those who practice Bhakti mixed with yoga, they are also called Sakama Bhaktas because they are desiring only moksha. And then the Kevala Bhakta. These devotees go back to Godhead. And they will get Mukti in the form of Sarishti, Salokya, Sahijya, not Sahijya, Sarishti, Salokya, Samipya and Sarupya. And the upper three people worship the Supreme Lord in Sukha and Aishwarya. The fourth person will worship the Supreme Lord in Prema. So this is the essence of 7th chapter. And one important word mentioned in the last verse, it is like Sadi Yajnam Chaye Vidu Prayana Kale Pichamam Te Vidu Yukta Chesa. So this is how the 7th chapter has been concluded by Lord Krishna. Anyone has any question? Yes, Prabhu. Little louder, Prabhuji.
Yes, Prabhuji, that Kevala Bhakta is also mentioned 7.30. That is also quality of Kevala Bhakta, 7.30.
No, 7.3, it is mentioned that the people who understand Kevala Bhakti, who understand about Lord's sweetness. Of course, 7.3 also we can take, but specifically the 7.1 talks about the attributes of the Uttama Bhakta. What kind of qualities the Bhakta should have. Otherwise, 7.3 says that Manushyanam Sahasreshu Kachit, only a rare person will understand about my transcendental nature. That also indicates 7.30. No, 7.30, it is like summary. 7.29 and 7.30, it is like summary. All these six kinds of devotees will understand about the seven items. And they will come to me. Even the Karma Mishra Bhakta, Yoga Mishra Bhakta, Jnana Mishra Bhakta also understand about the seven items. So, in that way. It is just a summary and connection to the next chapter. Hare Krishna. Someone wrote a question. Can a tabular form of different muktis and types of devotees eligible for the same be given? Okay, we'll try to do that. Otherwise, we have already discussed in the purport of verse number 16. Artho Jignash Radhartha, in that purport we have actually given all these details. You can cross check with the purport which is there in 3-4 pages. There all the details are mentioned by type of bhakti and kind of mukti. I will try to have a table also. Or it will be given a question to all of you. You can make the table and present it. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna.
In one verse, Krishna says that he knows the future also. So does he know that when the particular jiva is going to surrender to him? And if he knows, then where exactly the free will lies with the
jiva? Wait. What future? For that Lord Krishna mentioning in the verse number 26, Vedaham Samaditani Vartamanani Charjuna. That verse you are talking about?
Yes.
Okay. So whether Lord knows our free will or not. See one thing. In the material world, in spite of knowing everything, the Supreme Lord actually remains neutral. Lord does not want to interfere with our free will. Samoham sarvabhuteshu name dveshosi na priya. The Supreme Lord in the material world acts as Paramatma. Paramatma is in Yoga Nidra. He is indifferent to our free will. He just acts like the witness to our activities. He does not interfere in our free will. Unless until we take shelter of the Supreme Lord, we completely surrender to the Supreme Lord, then the Lord will take the responsibility of all our activities. That is called Yoga Kshema Vahamyam. All these things we will discuss in the 9th chapter, how Lord will take care of the devotees, he surrendered devotees. More details will be mentioned there. Right now in the 7th chapter, we are just introducing what are the different ways of performing bhakti. So this thing we'll discuss in the 9th chapter. Yes, Prabhuji. So here it is mentioned. Wanting to know about the 7 knowledge.
My question. My question was that if Krishna knows already in advance that I'm going to surrender after 100 life or some lifetime, then what is the point in giving the knowledge and all the yoga or the, because it is already clear that till 100 lifetimes I will not surrender to him.
See Prabhuji, after 100 lifetimes if you want to know Lord, you should have some knowledge of Lord, na? For those who want to know today, for those who want to know tomorrow, for those who want to know after 100 lifetimes, the knowledge should be there. That's why Lord Krishna speaks about that knowledge in Bhagavad Gita 7th chapter, 9th chapter, 10th and 11th chapters. If there is no knowledge, how will anyone will know ever about Krishna? Lord Krishna does not give knowledge specific to one person. He gives knowledge in general for everyone. Some person may surrender today only. So now he is given knowledge in the form of all the Vedic literature, which is meant for everyone. But an individual person, according to one's own choice, may want to understand, may want to surrender at a particular point of time, in a particular lifetime. That is subjected to individual person. But from Lord's point of view, he is always eager to take us all back home, back to Godhead. It is up to us whether we want to go back to Godhead or not, today or tomorrow.
But is it not that it is fixed that I will take certain amount of time?
Not fixed. If you want to surrender today itself, you can surrender. No one is stopping you. It is up to our desire whether I want to surrender completely today or not. Because we don't want to surrender to Lord Krishna today completely 100%. So our lifetimes will continue to extend. Next and next like that. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 10. It is up to us to completely surrender or not.
Okay.
So this is the last slide of this chapter. Wanting to know about the 7 knowledge items mentioned by Lord, that is Brahman, Adhyatma, Karma, Adibhuta, Adidaiva, Adiyajna and himself about Krishna, Arjuna asks questions about them in the first 2 verses of the next chapter. So, then we'll start with 8th chapter. Hare Krishna, anyone else has any question from 7th chapter? In the 8th chapter, being questioned by Arjuna, Lord Krishna will explain the different items starting with Brahman mentioned at the end of the last chapter. He will then explain, after explaining the meaning of the 7 items, then Lord Krishna will explain the 2 paths of bhakti. Bhakti mixed with yoga, that is yoga mishra bhakti, and pure bhakti, ananya bhakti. These 2 are explained. Basically, here Lord Krishna explains in the 8th chapter the goal, the attainment of the goal or perfection by the practice of yoga mishra bhakti and by the practice of pure bhakti. And then he will also describe the 2 types, describe the 2 destinations of the different variety of yogis. After the destination of yoga mishra bhakti and ananya bhakti, he also described the destiny of 2 other types of yogis. So these are the 4 different types of destinations are described in this chapter 18, attaining the supreme. So indirectly or directly, what we can understand this 8th chapter as, whatever Lord Krishna spoke in the previous 6 chapters and also in the 7th chapter, that he mentioned about various processes. And now in this chapter, Lord Krishna talks about their perfection, their destiny, where they will go, how they will leave from this world and attain the spiritual world. That is explained in this 8th chapter. So this is the breakup of the entire 8th chapter as it is presented by His Grace Gauranga Priya Prabhu. In first 4 verses, Lord Krishna answers to Arjuna's questions. 5-8, remembering Lord Krishna at the time of death. How one should remember Lord Krishna at the time of death and why? That is explained here. And 9-13 talks about remembering Lord Krishna by the practice of yoga. And 14-16, Lord Krishna talks about pure devotional service. And 17-22, comparing the material and spiritual worlds and the glories of the spiritual world are mentioned in the 17-22. And 23-28, the supremacy of pure devotion in attaining Lord Krishna is also shown. So the breakup of the entire chapter. The acronym given to this chapter is DEAD, D-E-A-D. Death is not the end, but the beginning. People of this world may talk that death is end to everything, but actually the scriptures say that death is actually the beginning of spiritual life. D stands for doubts given by Arjuna. Arjuna talks about, asks about the 7 questions to be clarified. And Lord Krishna answers 6 questions in first 4 verses. The 7th question is answered in the rest of the chapter. So then E stands for end of life, verses 5-8. The 7th is answered here. By leaving one's body at death, a devotee attains spiritual world. This is the essence of this section. And A stands for attaining the supreme, verses 9-12. The 9-13 talks about how yoga mishra bhaktas attain the spiritual world. 14-16 talks about how ananya bhaktas attain the spiritual world. 17-19, how other people who are neither practicing yoga mishra bhakti or nor practicing ananya bhakti will continue to take birth, continue the birth death cycle during Brahma's day and night. That is explained in the 17-19. And 20-22, it describes about the parandama, describes about the spiritual world. Because so many verses talking about going to spiritual world, a brief glimpse about that spiritual world is mentioned in these verses. And then last section, 20-28, the devotion is explained. Devotion of others who are neither practicing yoga mishra bhakti nor practicing ananya bhakti, their details are mentioned. The path of light and the path of darkness. Yeah, both kevala bhakti and ananya bhakti are same. These are the different names of shuddha bhakti. Pure devotional bhakti, or Shuddha Bhakti, Kevala Bhakti, Ananya Bhakti, Akinchana Bhakti, they are all same, called with different names at different places. So these are the different things is the subject matter of this entire chapter. Now we'll just start. We'll try to see few verses today and we'll continue with the remaining verses tomorrow. Here, in the first verse, Arjuna asks questions in order to understand the meaning of the 7 items, starting with Brahman mentioned as the object of knowledge for the person desiring liberation in the last chapter. So, in the first 2 verses, Arjuna asks his question. अर्जुन उवाच किं तद् ब्रह्म किम् अध्यात्मं किं कर्म पुरुषोत्तम अधिभूतं च किं प्रोक्तं अधिदैवं किमुच्यते अधियज्ञ कथं कोत्र देहेस्मिन् मधुसूदन प्रयाण काले च कथं ज्ञेयोऽसि नियतात्मभिः.
Yeah, Arjuna inquired, O my Lord, O Supreme Person, what is Brahman? What is the Self? What are fruitive activities? What is this material manifestation? And what are the demigods? Please explain this to me.
So, these are the 7 questions asked by Arjuna. So, Arjuna wanted to know the meaning of these 7 terms, which Lord Krishna briefly mentioned at the end of the previous chapter, saying that the person who practices Yoga Mishra Bhakti and even other persons who are practicing Karma Mishra Bhakti or Jnana Mishra Bhakti or Ananya Bhakti will know all these 7 things. Even they will remember me at the time of death. So now Arjuna wanted to know the meaning of these 7 things. So as Arjuna was asking all these questions, Lord Krishna asked a written question. Since both of us are equals, why do you ask me such questions? I think you also know all the meaning of all these terms. Why are you asking me? Then Arjuna addresses Lord Krishna as Purushottama. Because you are the Supreme Lord, you know everything. Whereas I do not know. Thus, I want you to tell me all these questions. And the second verse Lord Krishna was addressed as Madhusudana. Then Arjuna says that all these doubts are like different demons. So you are the killer of demon Madhu. So may you clarify all my doubts. Letting him understand that it will be easy for the Lord to remove all his doubts, Arjuna is asking his doubts to Lord Krishna only instead of asking somebody else. So Lord Krishna closes these questions. The intention is, at the time of death, because of the impossibility of concentrating the mind due to disturbances of all the senses, how are you to be known? So basically, in the previous chapter, Lord Krishna told that even at the time of death, one will remember me. One will remember all these 7 items. Then Arjuna says that it seems that death is very a precarious condition. One will not be able to remember you. How I will be able to remember you at the time of death? So this is the main question asked by Arjuna. So Prabhupada writes in the purport, now the word prayana kala in this verse is very significant because whatever do in life will be tested at the time of death. This is from the second purport. Arjuna is very anxious to know of those who are constantly engaged in Krishna consciousness. What should be their position in that final moment of death? At the time of death, all the bodily functions are disrupted and the mind is not in a proper condition. Thus, disturbed by the bodily situation, one may not be able to remember the Supreme Lord. And then Prabhupada quotes Maharaj Kulashekara, a great devotee, who actually prayed that, my dear Lord, now I am in youth. I am able to practice bhakti very easily and very sincerely. In my old age, I am not sure that whether I will be able to remember you or not. So it is good that let me get death now. If I get death now, I am sure that I will be able to enter into spiritual world. If I have to live till the old age, I will not be able to remember you. I may not be sure. This is the prayer of Kulashekara Maharaj. This is one of the favorite verses of Srila Prabhupada, who always used to recite this verse. Krishna Tvadiya Padapanka Japanjarantam Adyaivame Vasatumana Sarajahamsa Prane Prayana Samayeka Pavata Pitta Kantavarodana Vidau Smaratam Kutaste. Here in Kulashekara Maharaj said that Krishna Tvadiya Padapankaja Panjarantam Adyaivame Vishatu Manasa Rajahamsa. Just like a Rajahamsa, a swan goes deep within the lotus and tries to attract the nectar. Similarly, currently my mind is concentrated on your lotus feet and experiencing the bliss of your lotus feet. But prane prayana samaye kapavata pittau. At the time of death, my body will be overwhelmed by kapha, vata, pitta. And my body will be going through a lot of troubles. Like that as kantava rodha navidau. My kanta, my throat will be filled with kapha and I will not be able to recite your holy name. And my mind will not be able to remember you. So it is better that let me get death right now. So that I am sure that I will enter into spiritual world. So Prabhupada says that this should be the desire should be cultivated by devotee, even a devotee. So thus Prabhupada says, Arjuna questions how a person can fix his mind on Krishna's lotus feet at the time of death. This is the main question. It will be answered elaborately in this chapter. So now, being asked, the Lord replies to these 7 questions one by one. In the verse number 3, Lord... So in the verse number 3, Lord Krishna answers 3 questions. In the verse number 4, Lord Krishna answers 3 more. And in the future verses 5 to 8, he answers the Prayanakala. Aksharam Brahma Paramam Swabhavo Adhyatma Mochyate Bhuta Bhavo Dbhavakaro Visarga Karma Sanyita.
The Supreme Personality of Godhead said, the indestructible, transcendental living entity is called Brahman and his eternal nature is called Adhyatma, the self. Action pertaining to the development of the material bodies of the living entities is called karma or fruitive activities.
So here, Lord Krishna gives the meaning of the 3 words, Brahma, Adhyatma and karma. And karma is explained very elaborately, very nice, interesting understanding presented here in this verse. So let us see what it is. So the question of Arjuna was, what is that Brahman? Is it the conscious Paramatma or the conscious Jiva? Is Brahman is conscious Paramatma or the conscious Jiva? So Lord Krishna answers, Aksharam Brahma Paramam. The Jivatma, which does not perish, which is distinct from the body, the material body, is called Brahman. Brahman is not Paramatma. Instead, Brahman is Jivatma, which is actually eternal and which is different from the temporary body. Shruti states that Jiva is called Brahma and Aksharam. These are the different ways Jiva is addressed. So this is how Lord Krishna defines what is Brahman. Brahman is nothing but Jivatma, which is eternal and which is superior to the temporary body. And then next question is, what is Adhyatma? What is it that superintends the body? Adi Atma. Is it the group of senses or a group of subtle elements? So Lord Krishna answers, Swabhavo Adhyatma Muchyate. Our Swabhava is our Adhyatma. I refer to the Swabhava as Adhyatma. Swabhava is that subtle. Swabhava is that substance, bhava means padartha, intimately connected to the jiva. Swabhava is that substance is intimately connected to all of us. It is nothing but the impressions held in the subtle elements which accompany the jiva birth after birth and that govern the body. So basically here Lord Krishna says, Swabhava is nothing but our independent and individual nature are the impressions that are held within our subtle body. All the impressions that are stored within our mind, intelligence, ego and chetana and which will follow us from one body to other body. Because of those impressions, we behave in a particular way and we live in a particular way. we respond in a particular way. We will be known as a person of particular nature. No. Here there is a question. Is Brahman the effulgence of Supreme Personality of Godhead? No. Here the Brahman is referring to the Jivatma. Aham Brahmosmi. In that context. Here the Brahman is actually the Jivatma. It is not the effulgence of the Supreme Lord. So, why Jivatma we'll discuss while discussing the next verse. So basically Brahman is Jivatma. And Adhyatma is our individual nature or our own impressions which we are carrying from life to life, which are actually governing all our life's activities. And then the third question, the next line talks about the third question. What is karma? Does this refer to ordinary day-to-day activities or actions prescribed by the Vedas? And Lord Krishna says, Bhuta Bhavodbhava Karo Visarga Karma Sanjita. That means that creative force which gives rise to the bodies, Udbhavakara, giving rise to the different bodies of men and others. Others includes the devatas, the animals, the plants. By the combination of the grass and subtle elements is called karma. Karma is that which gives us the material body, the human body, the animal body, the bird's body, the plant's body, and the devata body. This is called karma. It is that creative force which will give us a particular body is called as karma. Yeah, yes. Swabhava, in general, Swabhava takes us from one species to other species and gives us a particular nature. But when we surrender to Supreme Lord and practice Bhakti, that Swabhava will be purified and we will develop that Swabhava as Jivera Swarupai Krishnera Nityadas. That is possible. So there is one more question. So Lord Krishna describes about karma. So Lord Krishna going to talk about Chandogya Upanishad, chapter 5, wherein he describes that the five offerings of faith, they are called God of the moon, rain, food, and semen, are offered into the five fires of heaven, the God of rain, earth, man, and woman. By these five things, by the performance of Jyotishtoma sacrifice, one goes to Swarga and enjoys in a devata body with the remnants of piety, comes to earth and gets a body. So the process